Few jobs endure the level of scrutiny that major sports coaches do. And it's no different in MMA. I mean, you never see people publicly shame backpackers at Walmart for placing the heavy goods at the top of a bag, which is a horrific and cardinal sin, by the way. Yet we fans sit in our armchairs on a Saturday night and proclaim that the tactics devised by professionals who train fighters daily were in fact wrong. What we need to remember here is that fighters, and more importantly for this video, coaches, are people too, and people are inherently flawed. However, some coaches are a lot more flawed than others. And whether this is their outright bizarre training methods or sometimes even their apparent lack of interest in their clients, these coaches manage to piss off a large contingent of fans and experts. I'm Jason from MMA on Point, and these are the 10 most controversial coaches in MMA. Number 10, Rampage Jackson, Tough 7 and Tough 10. Rampage will forever be known as one of MMA's most entertaining characters and legendary fighters as a real pioneer of the sport, but is he a good coach? Well, after two stints leading teams on The Ultimate Fighter, we got our answer, and spoiler alert, he's not great. First, just look at his results. If you combine the two seasons, his team went 5-17, an underwhelming performance by any means, but that's only the tip of the iceberg. In fights, he offered no technical guidance to his fighters, aside from periodically shouting things like, get up when they are on the ground, which is corner work you'd usually hear from a drunk fan and not a coach. I mean, it's obvious, right? And sure, he was entertaining, but that wasn't really practical for his job, and while his jokes about Daryl's titties on the show were pretty amazing and almost enough to get him bumped off the list, it's not exactly great coaching material. Furthermore, despite the show featuring prominent names like Kimbo Slice, Roy Nelson, and Brendan Schaub, Quinton turned it into the Rampage show rather than elevating them. However, his worst offense was the apparent disregard he had for his team. Technical coaching aside, he rarely consoled them in defeat, which was essentially their default state, and he later blamed this on the show's poor editing. But from what we saw, he was anything but a committed mentor. Nevertheless, with such charisma and a fan-friendly fighting style, it's hard to dislike Rampage despite being one of the show's worst coaches. But yeah, it's definitely about to get a lot worse. Number 9, Lou Pauly, Tough 13. Head coaches on The Ultimate Fighter play a significant role in the production. As established stars, they're tasked with leading their teams while also driving the ratings. Assistant coaches, on the other hand, are customarily the equivalent of film extras. Background fodder, really. But during season 13, headed by Junior Dos Santos and Brock Lesnar, the Brazilian's assistant wrestling coach, Lou Pauly, overstepped his bounds, culminating in Dos Santos kicking him off of the show. The problem was that Lou couldn't help but contradict Dos Santos repeatedly. When Junior told everyone to go after the finish, Lou preached to win at all costs, didn't care how it was done. When Dos Santos, one of the best heavyweight strikers in MMA history, was teaching the fundamentals of the jab, Pauly, a grappler, thought it would be a good idea to interject. It got to the point where Dos Santos was forced to remind him that the competition wasn't between the two of them, but coaching the team to win against, you know, the other team. And then it all came to a head when Pauly tried visiting the fighter's house without running it by Chigano, continuing this trend of overstepping his bounds. And taking it as a sign of disrespect, Dos Santos finally kicked him off of the show. Like Rampage, Pauly claimed that the show's editors made him look bad, but Junior's firing makes it pretty clear that the editing was hardly his issue. Number 8, Matt Hughes. Okay, so it's safe to say that The Ultimate Fighter brings out the worst of people. And yes, normal coaches will be on this list too, so don't worry about that. But with two stints coaching on the show in the mid-2000s, Matt Hughes has given us ample insight into how he operates when he's on the other side of the fence. And unlike in the Octagon, he doesn't bask himself in the glory. In season 2, he routinely bullied Rich Franklin's team, and while it's not uncommon for coaches to provoke the opposition, he didn't seem fond of many of his own fighters either, in particular Jason Von Flew. Hughes even said that he wouldn't have cared if Von Flew lost his fight. Hughes was then forced to give up one of his team members in a reshuffling, and he named Von Flew without skipping a beat, claiming that he was the worst fighter left in the show. Really harsh for a guy who has a whole submission named after him, you know, the Von Flew choke. In season 6, Hughes returned with
great vengeance and furious anger,
and decided to push his particular brand of Christianity on people. In one training session, he handed out Bibles and asked his team to find a biblical figure that represented him, which is both weird as hell and super egotistical. Furthermore, he blamed every single loss on either a lack of effort or else a failure to follow his instructions exactly. This, combined with a high school jock-like attitude, ironically the antithesis of most biblical figures, making Hughes one of the most controversial coaches coaches in tough history. Number 7, Conor McGregor. As someone who experiments with his own training, as you'll soon see, the former champ put an unusual twist on coaching throughout the Ultimate Fighter Season 22. From the very get-go, while contestants were still licking their wounds from the preliminary bout, Conor, who by definition is the head coach, flat out said he's not there to coach anyone. He essentially disassembled Team Europe, explaining that it's an individual contest and everyone is there just to boost themselves, him included, which is undeniably controversial whether you agree with him on the approach or not. And yeah, it is technically true, maybe just not better said for a, you know, team. Conor opted to miss morning training sessions altogether, only attending the evening technical classes, which is opposite the very involved coach, Team Alpha Male leader Uriah Faber, who disagreed with him openly about this.
I would like to see him show up a little more for his guys, because although you can't hold someone's hand, I feel like you can give them every advantage.
On top of this, SBG Ireland's Artem Lobov got some preferential treatment, showing that McGregor actually had the ability to be more than a supportive mentor to the other Team Europe members. I mean, he gave him the wild card slot, could have picked anyone else. He also called one of the guys on his team literally a pussy and a bitch. There you go. That was because he went to his back so many times during the fight, and going on to say that he doesn't care about you if you're not serious about winning. Not sure if that's the coach many people would want. Otherwise, plenty of his efforts were used elsewhere to goad Faber into fighting TJ Dillashaw, although he wasn't exactly wrong about it, and it did give us the infamous snake in the grass quote. Number 6, Brock Lesnar's coaches. Finally, someone not untough. But basically, unless they're machines like Donald Cerrone or Angela Hill, fighters only get real experience a few times a year, so sparring is a crucial element of most training camps. This is perhaps doubly true for someone making a late transition to MMA as Brock Lesnar did in the mid-2000s. And while there has been a shift away from excessive sparring in recent years, there's no doubt that it still has its place. Lesnar's team, however, rejected that idea completely. At Team Death Clutch and Minnesota Martial Arts Academy, where Lesnar trained under Greg Nelson, they would rarely spar. His training partners were also urged to go very light on him, to the point where head strikes were usually off limits. It's kind of like jobbers, a pro wrestling term that is used to describe no names designed to lose and make the wrestler look good. The equivalent for MMA training reportedly is what went down for Lesnar to squash and get a quick boost in confidence. Sure, Pat Barry was there too, but he was also reportedly told to go super light. And while belief is unquestionably important for a fighter, having adequate tests through training partners is imperative when his future assignments would include Alistair Overeem and Cain Velasquez, the latter of whom literally punched him across the octagon. Nevertheless, Lesnar still managed to win and defend the UFC's heavyweight title.
I'm a white boy and I'm jacked. Deal with it.
But to this day, pundits and fans wonder how much success he could have had if his training was a bit more authentic to that of every other fighter. Number 5, Ken Shamrock. Fighting since before the UFC debuted at Pancrase, Ken Shamrock has pretty much seen it all. He even founded the Lion's Den, one of the very first legitimate mixed martial arts gyms to open in North America. And while it's no secret that the sport has dramatically evolved since they first opened their doors, Shamrock's approach to training didn't. Back in the day, his gym held tryouts for would-be team members, which consisted of Darwinistic survival of the fittest type regimen, where his gluttony for punishment would make them perform 500 squats, 200 push-ups, and 200 sit-ups, followed by running and sparring. Again, this is all just to get into the gym in the first place. I mean, geez, I'm tired just saying that. Ultimately, those few maniacs who did survive could then join the team and spend their day sharpening iron with iron. And although this approach seems medieval and crude by today's standards, it was a winning formula back in the mid-1990s. However, when Shamrock coached tough in 2006, we quickly found out that his methods, which he stubbornly clung to all these years later, were vastly outdated by then. He started by first overtraining his team in the evaluation stages, leading to unwanted rest days when they should have been capitalizing on their exposure to an elite coach like him. Or so that was the perception. But that wasn't the only issue. He didn't actually use a jiu-jitsu coach. I don't know how that's possible, but he did employ a bodybuilder by the name of Dan Freeman as a nutritionist who recommended steaks the day before weigh-ins. And instead of training, he would sometimes show his old fight footage. Yeah, they would just watch tapes. And all the while, he was just plainly more preoccupied with Ortiz, who was clearly getting under his skin. Believe it or not, many of his team openly wished they could join Tito's. Number 4, Greg Jackson. So on this one, I'm not here to tell you that Jackson is a bad coach, just that he has had controversy in the past, which is the point of this video. Jackson Week has played home to some of MMA's greats, including the likes of George St. Pierre and John Jones. But with great exposure comes great scrutiny, and too bad that doesn't include a superhero-like costume with a phrase. If you ask Dana White, he'll probably tell you that Jackson's greatest sin was the hand he played in UFC 151's cancellation. John Jones was scheduled to defend his light heavyweight title then against Dan Henderson, but just a week out from the fight, Henderson revealed that he had to withdraw because of an injury. Chael Sonnen volunteered for the near impossible task of moving up in weight class to challenge Jones. However, Jackson advised his student to decline the bout, stating that accepting it would be the biggest mistake of his career. Hyperbole alert, anyone. So Dana, in classic Dana fashion, branded Jackson as a quote, fucking sport killer. And whether you agree with Jackson's advice or not, it's clear that he did divide the fan base. One side argued that the ease in which Jones would beat Chael less than a year later is proof enough that he should have just taken the fight, while others insisted it would be foolish to take such a risk with so much on the line on such short notice. Regardless, controversy followed Jackson beyond this, and he's often also blamed, perhaps unjustly, for turning fun fighters into dull ones. The chief example of this is when he coached Clay Guida's uncharacteristic tentative performance against Gray Maynard, as well as Carlos Condit's alleged point fighting against Nick Diaz. He's also regularly accused of being the driving force behind GSP and John Jones' transformations into risk-averse fighters, although I'm sure he'd argue he's just doing his job in creating world champions. And just to clarify, I'm not endorsing these views, I'm just telling you what the controversy is and that it does exist. You do you, Greg Jackson. Number 3, Ido Portal. Oh yeah, you guys knew this one was coming. Being an early adopter of potentially innovative training methods can give a fighter that edge that might make all the difference come fight night. Hicks and Gracie famously swore by peculiar breathing exercises, which he has passed on to his son Crone. GSP was the godfather of blending gymnastics with MMA practice. And for Tony Ferguson, he pretty much just does whatever the hell he does. Like I said with Jackson, you do you, Tony. Conor McGregor tried to get his edge by introducing the movement culture to MMA through Ido Portal. And although this wasn't a totally new concept, his own distinct brand of it definitely was. Working with the Irishman since before the Jose Aldo fight, Portal is a movement specialist, but he also has a background in capoeira, so to be fair, he's not totally new to martial arts. And if you at least examine his principles objectively, it's not that crazy to believe his addition could have benefited McGregor's camp even in just a small way. However, he's also been heavily criticized, chiefly by Nate Diaz.
You're playing touch butt with that dork in the park. The ponytail.
Fighters, coaches, and analysts have all questioned how beneficial his training methods really are, with some suggesting that they're entirely ineffective and serve only as placebos. Chael Sonnen himself even proposed that Portal was using McGregor as a means for self-promotion. And there might even be some truth to all of that. I mean, will playing touch butt in the park actually help you in preparation to fight Nate Diaz? The results kind of don't look good on that. In truth, it's hard to say, but let's be real, that time would probably be served better on a treadmill, right? Who knows? Maybe this place I'm resting my arm on is just getting a little bit too comfortable. Number 2, Joshua Fabio. Fabio, that's the one. Okay, so you guys all know that this one is bizarre. If you're not familiar with Joshua Fabio or how he fits into Diego Sanchez's camp, buckle up and we'll actually let the man himself explain.
I'm his coach, trainer, manager. You know, I'm the physical therapist, I'm the nutritionist.
I know what you're thinking. That sounds like a lot of responsibilities for somebody who seemingly came out of nowhere, but fear not, he does have experience in things. He founded the School of Self-Awareness, which is known for running classes on breathing, movement, magic, and mystery. You know, standard stuff. He also teaches what he calls the SOS survival method, and I might be going out on a limb here, but it doesn't look like it applies to MMA.
He's done, because I have his balls in his throat. Okay, pretty simple. Balls in throat. That's gonna be the key on the ground.
But wait, there's more. According to Emil Meek, Fabio, wielding a knife, would chase students around the gym as part of his training method. And while that might prepare him for the off chance that their opponent brandishes a concealed knife in the octagon, it doesn't seem like the best use of an athlete's time. Jury's out on that one, folks. Fabio also reportedly warned the commission before UFC 239 that he and Sanchez had worked on a choke so brutal it could paralyze or even kill his opponent, Michael Chiesa. I'd like to commend Max and front of everyone here for his choice in dramatic music during that statement. So yeah, this left people speculating about whether Fabia had any real martial arts experience at all. He did have a chance to clear the air when interviewed by Luke Thomas after Sanchez's fight with Michelle Pereira, but he had nothing of substance at all to say. He did, however, claim that Sanchez had demonstrated a Floyd Mayweather level of defense in the bout, which is hilarious. He might be the most bewildering coach, I mean cornerman, nutritionist, I mean manager, whatever the fuck he claims to be. He definitely would be number one on this list had he been around longer by the time of this video, but I'm sure you can guess who number one is gonna be right in about 3, 2, oh yeah, number one, Edmund Tarverdian. Before Star People's rousing success put him under a microscope, yeah, you see what I did there?
Oh, boo.
Glendale Fighting Club's Edmund Tarverdian was a relative nobody to MMA fans, but once they took a closer look during Ronda Rousey's dominant run as champion, they quickly turned on him. Despite training the most dominant grappler in women's MMA at the time, he, for some reason, believed that she was Bangkok ready and leaned straight into it. He proclaimed that her boxing was the best in the division and that she'd drop world champion boxers in the gym. Sure, Holly Holm and Amanda Nunes made sure that the first part of that statement was unequivocally wrong.
Edmund!
And even Ronda's mom questioned Edmund's coaching acumen, going as far as publicly advising people to avoid his gym. But it did not end with Ronda. The three other fighters that comprised her Four Horsemen stable had a disastrous 0-11 combined record while training under Tarverdian. And Travis Brown didn't fare much better. He went from the brink of having a title shot with a 16-2-1 record to teaming up with Tarverdian and losing his next 5 of 7 fights. Not a great look. There was also a small legal issue, just a teeny tiny one, where he had to pay $160,000 in a settlement for fraudulently filing for bankruptcy while allegedly at the height of his earning powers, but that's a story for another time. Anyway, he could make a resurgence by having guided legitimate prospect Edmund Shahbazyan into the UFC, but let's be real, for some, including me, that's a bit of an outlier situation and his past is far too checkered not to make number one. I'd like to give a huge shout out to Charlie Howard, and actually, you guys might remember a guy by the name of Rob Palin, who's been helping us out with these scripts and working together. We got a whole crew on these now. You can follow Charlie at MMA_Charlie, and you can follow Rob Palin at the Robert Palin on Twitter. We're very creative people with our usernames here. And of course, you gotta give it up to the main man,
the MacDaddy,
for editing this video. You can follow him on Twitter at another creative name, at Max_Randall. Thanks for watching my list, guys. If you enjoyed the video, subscribe and like. We upload at least 3 videos per week about MMA, and it really helps us out when you do so. If I missed anything on this vid, let me know in the comments, and feel free to follow me on Twitter at JasonTheHeart or follow the official channel account at OnPointMMA. Thanks for watching so much, and I'll catch you on the next video.